You know what's cool? Cartoons. You want to know something else that's cool? Video games. If you were to put these two things together, the results must always be great, right? Well, unfortunately, that's not always the case. Just like their silver screen counterparts, animated adaptations of video games are often hit or miss. Many seem like cheap cash grabs that don't take advantage of the games they're adapting. Despite this, there have been instances where things go well, and we get a series that makes fans of the franchise proud. Hey guys, I'm Brad with WickedBinge, and this is Cartoons Based on Video Games, Worst to Best. And before we begin, if you're a fan of our WickedBinge format and video games, make sure to subscribe to our channel, 1UpBinge. Some of the videos we've made include Super Mario Villains, Evil to Most Evil, Kirby Villains, Evil to Most Evil, and Team Fortress 2 characters, Good to Evil. Link is in the description, so check us out over there. Now today, we'll be looking at many of these adaptations and determining which ones to check out and which ones shouldn't have gotten the green light. However, we won't be looking at every series based on a video game, just the ones we feel are the most significant. We're also not going to look at any Pokemon adaptations because, well, that could be a list on its own. Lastly, we'll be judging these shows not only on how entertaining they are, but also how faithful they are to the games they were based on. With all that out of the way, let the games begin. For this list, we'll be starting off with the worst entries and working our way up to the best shows. So let's get this started. Earning the title of Worst Adaptation, we have Tack and the Power of Juju. A lot of you are probably watching this right now and have no idea what Tack is. In a nutshell, it was a series of games produced by Nickelodeon in the mid-2000s. Nick heavily promoted the games, putting trailers for them inside various Nickelodeon games and DVDs. Being that Nickelodeon is focused primarily on television, an animated adaptation seemed inevitable. Unfortunately, Power of Juju is easily the worst show we're covering for this list. In terms of accuracy to the games, things are about how you'd expect them to be. The show follows Tack, a boy who can summon the power of the Jujus, as he goes on various adventures with his friends in the Pupununu tribe. All the characters look how they do in the games, but they strangely don't sound the same. Of all the voice actors featured in the cartoon, Patrick Warburton is the only one to reprise his role from the games. He betrays Locke, a warrior in the tribe who is a chicken. He's probably one of the funnier characters in the series, even if Warburton has played better versions of this character. Besides a decent Patrick Warburton performance and that it resembles the Tack games, there's really nothing here to go back to. The storylines are the kind you'd find in every other cartoon, and the show never seems interested in taking advantage of its fantasy adventure elements. This could have been an exciting story-centric cartoon, but it's just a sitcom in the vein of everything else on Nickelodeon at the time. The animation is far from good. Even compared to shows of its time like Jimmy Neutron, it feels like a step back. But what really gets this show the last spot on this list is that it inarguably killed the franchise it was birthed from. After the show's end in 2009, Tack has not been heard from since. This is far from the only bad show on this list, but none of the others had such a disastrous effect on their series. For all the Tack fans, you'd be better off sticking with the games and ignoring this show ever happened. Next is Captain N, the Game Master. On paper, Captain N sounds like it has the perfect setup for an awesome show. The series takes place in Videoland, a world made up of NES classics like Castlevania and Kid Icarus. When the world is attacked by the evil Mother Brain and her lackeys, they pull a teenager named Kevin from the real world to help save Videoland. He is the titular Game Master. Sadly, Captain N felt more like a waste of potential. It includes characters and references to so many NES games, but it rarely does any of them justice. This is definitely not a show to watch if you're looking for game accuracy. For whatever reason, Mega Man is a lot more green than blue, Simon Belmont looks weird, trading in his armor from the games for pilot goggles, their personalities are off too. Simon Belmont is a coward, which isn't what you would expect for a guy who battles Dracula. Mega Man constantly spouts out the word Mega, which tells you everything you need to know about how creative the show is.
We've got to warp there mega fast!
Captain N also feels more interested in advertising NES games and telling any kind of compelling story. We're not kidding when we say a major character in this show is a literal Game Boy.
What's a Game Boy?
And the original characters can't save this show either. Kevin is the reluctant hero we've seen in tons of stories like this, and you can't help but wish they'd focus on the game characters whenever he's on screen. Princess Lana, the head of Videoland, is the only character that doesn't totally seem generic. You'd think she'd be a standard damsel in distress, but she actually is able to keep up with the rest of the N-team. Even though her characterization is a little more interesting than her companions, she's not memorable. Captain N is a hot mess. Being more focused on advertising games than telling a story, it highlights everything people dislike about 80s cartoons. Want a massive crossover with Nintendo characters? Just take our advice and play Super Smash Bros. Next is Sonic Underground. As soon as the intro begins, this might be the most radical reimagining of Sonic's world in any of his animated outings. After the evil Dr. Robotnik takes over Mobius, Queen Alina goes into hiding. She gives birth to three children, Sonic, Sonya, and Manic. Alina separates them after an oracle tells her of a great prophecy, where the four will reunite and save Mobius. Years later, the children come together and make a vow that their mother will be found. As for the last of the Deke-produced Sonic cartoons, they unfortunately saved the worst for last. Sonic Underground is a step down from their previous attempts at adapting the Blue Blur.
So where do we wind up?
It doesn't add anything new. All the new characters fail to be as memorable as those introduced in the preceding shows. To sum it up, the show is just the worst version of concepts used in those other Sonic cartoons. Dr. Robotnik being the ruler of Mobius, done better in the earlier shows. Two bumbling henchmen who follow his orders, that was done better too. Did we mention this show is also a musical? Yep, for whatever reason, Sonic and his siblings possess medallions that can turn into instruments. Each episode features a musical number, and well, Phineas and Ferb, this is not. None of the songs stand out, and they're little more than a thinly veiled attempt at padding out the runtime of the episodes. Not even the voice cast can save this show. Although we must admit, there is something charming about Jaleel White voicing all the Sonic siblings. Yes, he voices Sonya too. The only noteworthy thing in this show is the first time Knuckles the Echidna appeared in an animated series. However, like many other elements, he's done far better in later shows. Animation errors reign supreme, and they can also be a source of unintentional comedy. We rate this one so low on the list because there's no shortage of Sonic cartoons that are actually enjoyable to watch. With plenty of competition, there's basically no reason to go back and watch this. That is, unless you thought Sonic could always show off his musical abilities more. The next entry takes us to Pac-World with Pac-Man and the Ghostly Adventures. The show debuted in 2013 and focuses on Pac-Man and his friends, Spiral and Cylindria. After Pac-Man accidentally opens a portal to the Netherworld, ghosts begin to run amok all over Pacopolis. It's up to them to stop these ghosts, led by the one named Petraeus, from taking over the world. This show gets a lot of flack from fans, stemming mainly from Pac's redesign. Smash Bros. Creator Masahiro Sakurai even stated that he would have rejected Pac-Man if he was forced to use this design while developing the fourth installment in the series. However, things don't get any better once you get past the new look. If we were to sum this show up in one word, it would be generic.
But to defeat them, you must eat them.
Pac-Man is a blank slate in terms of story because they came up with the least inspired idea. It's Pac in high school, and he runs into trouble balancing his heroic duties with his academic activities. We've seen this concept in a ton of cartoons, and this series doesn't add much to make it stand out from the crowd. Pac-Man is a dull protagonist, and his two friends aren't unique either. Pac follows the classic hero's journey story structure, and it's done about as generically as it could be. The only real interesting thing about the show is how the ghosts of the Pac-Man games, Inky, Pinky, Blinky, and Clyde, are actually heroes in this show. It's a nice twist on the original games, which you can't say about the rest of the show. Oddly, this was produced by Avi Arad. That name might not ring a bell, but he's the producer of films such as Iron Man and all the Spider-Man films. That's right, the man who helped launch the Marvel Cinematic Universe also came up with the story for this. To say this show doesn't meet the standards of his other work would be an understatement. We're going back to the realm of 1996. Next is Mortal Kombat, Defenders of the Realm. This series revolves around a group of fighters put together by Lord Raiden. The team strives to keep Earthrealm safe from any and all invaders from opposing realms. Mortal Kombat has lots of good going for it, a wide variety of fighters from the classic games, and they look how you'd expect them to be. The voice cast is impressive, featuring the legendary Ron Perlman as both Scorpion and Striker. Clancy Brown lends a sarcastic voice to the Thunder God Raiden. This series even marks the first appearance of Quan Chi, who would become a major villain in the games following this series. What could possibly go wrong? Well, everything. Right off the bat, we have a cartoon based on a series of games known for its high amounts of violence airing on Saturday mornings. that's kind of weird. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. Many of the character choices are strange. Nightwolf, a shaman in the games, spends most episodes behind a computer. The fighters ride around in these strange airships that feel like rejected toy designs. The first episode features the ice ninja Sub-Zero, aiding the heroes in a difficult battle. Despite this, they are slow to trust him, fearing he will betray them. Wouldn't this have been more impactful if we had actually seen Sub-Zero progress as a character before this? Imagine if he had started as an enemy, and then got a redemption arc. At the very least, it would have been far better than the story the episode presents. The show is conflicted as to whether it's based on the video games or the movie series that was going on at the same time. The characters are clearly based off their game counterparts. Still, they make many references and even show flashbacks to the events of the movies. It's like, pick a lane! Like, choose a continuity and follow it. Weird characterization and lack of blood aside, there isn't much else to it. The fight choreography is non-existent, and you'll be lucky to see the characters ever exist in an area that isn't a bluish cave. The games had so many interesting locations, and barely any of them show up. If you're a diehard MK fan, we recommend that you check out the 2020 animated movie Scorpion's Revenge. It has all the fighting and violence you'd want in an animated Mortal Kombat project. Leave this show in the past, unless you really are a big fan of Mortal Kombat characters spewing out one-liners. Jumping from one fighting game adaptation to another, we have 1995's Street Fighter. In this series, we follow Colonel William Guile, who has put together a team known as the Street Fighters. The team consists of fighters from all over the world. They work together to keep the planet safe from the tyranny of M. Bison. Starting off with the bad, Street Fighter suffers many of the same problems that plague Defenders of the Realm. This show is another weird mashup of sources, taking inspiration from the games and the 1994 movie. The fight choreography is not interesting, and there are many weird differences from the source material. Zangief is, for some reason, a villain, and the show as a whole resembles G.I. Joe a lot more than Street Fighter. With that being said, Mortal Kombat may have been boring, but this show is fun. There are animation errors and weird lines everywhere. Who could forget Bison gloating about killing his father and not whining about it?
If I had not seen it, I wouldn't believe it.
The show never fails to be entertaining, and we can't bring ourselves to say the same for MK, which is such a chore to watch in comparison. Despite being a fun watch, it's still far from being genuinely good. This is another one you can jot down as being more focused on selling toys than telling a story with this beloved franchise. We can't recommend this one to fans. We assure you, there are several other Street Fighter animated adaptations that are far more worth your time.
And you! You're a loser!
Even in the world of Street Fighter content that is so bad, it's good, you have better options. Watch the Van Damme movie if you want a Street Fighter story with that kind of feel, and leave this show in the dollar DVD bin at your local supermarket. The next entry is gonna take us into the third dimension for Donkey Kong Country. The show focuses on Donkey Kong, protector of the Crystal Coconut, and resident of Congo Bongo Island. The villain is King K. Rool, and his minions are determined to steal the item. They seek its power to grant wishes that can give him control of the entire island. With some help from his friends, Donkey Kong works to prevent K. Rool from getting the coconut and becoming the island's ruler. Beginning in 1996, Donkey Kong was one of the first shows to take advantage of motion capture technology, and it shows. While we commend the team for pushing what was possible in 3D animation at the time, the results are nothing short of uncanny. DK and the rest of the crew look freaky at times and hilariously off-model at others. Like Sonic Underground before it, this show also has musical numbers. There are two in each episode, and well, they're at least better than the Sonic ones. We won't lie though, some of these songs go hard. If you don't love Nobody's Hero, we cannot trust you. Speaking of things we like, we'll commend the show for featuring so many of the other major characters from the games. From Donkey and Diddy to King K. Rool, your favorite character probably shows up in this series. Although they act as they do in the games, DK appears to be less sharp than his game counterpart. There are even a few new characters added into the mix. They don't feel out of place in the way many new additions tend to feel in these shows. Buster Kong, in particular, is a good source of comic relief. We can't really call this show good, but it is a lot like Street Fighter. It never ceases to be entertaining, and you're bound to get a laugh out of it. Maybe not for the reasons intended, but who are we to judge? Regardless, if you love the games, this one might be up your alley. Next is Ruby Spears' Mega Man. In this series, we follow Mega Man, an advanced robot who can copy the abilities of other robots. He uses these abilities in his fights to save the world from the evil tyranny of Dr. Wily. Mega Man gets points from us because it feels like a show made by people who are genuinely interested in bringing this franchise to life. Dozens of robot masters from the NES games appear in this series, and all the major characters act like you'd expect them to. Mega Man is determined to seek justice. Meanwhile, Dr. Wily is just as jealous of his former colleague, Dr. Light's success, as he is in the games. Proto Man, Mega Man's brother, also frequently appears to cause trouble for the Blue Bomber, like in the early installments of the games. However, most interesting was that this show had a crossover with Mega Man X, a spin-off of the main Mega Man games that takes place in the future. Mega Man can be entertaining, but several things hold the show back. Every episode follows the same beats. We don't even mean they all follow the standard Wily tries to conquer Earth storyline. Most episodes revolve around some sort of technology that Wily is obsessed with finding, and Mega Man has to stop him from getting a hold of it. It gets tiresome after a while. The show's art style is also something we aren't too fond of. The show trades in the manga-inspired look of the games, which even early pitches used, for a more traditional comic book look. This may have been a bad move, as the manga influence would have no doubt made it stand out in a sea of superhero cartoons. It could have even capitalized on the anime boom that was beginning to take shape in America. Sadly, we got a show that looks like every action cartoon from around that time, which extends to the show's feel as well. Many of these storylines feel like they could have happened in any Marvel or DC cartoon, so long as you switched out the names. Even with its heavy use of the Mega Man characters, it never truly feels like a Mega Man cartoon. It's an average superhero cartoon with a Mega Man coat of paint, and that's why we can't rank it any higher. The next spot on the list takes us to the land of Hyrule with 1989's The Legend of Zelda. This cartoon takes inspiration from the first two games in the series. It follows the adventures of the hero Link and Princess Zelda as they fight to keep Hyrule and the Triforce of Wisdom safe from the villainous Ganon. To save the best for last, let's start with the bad in the show. Ganon is a weak villain. What makes his failing as an antagonist worse is that he appears intimidating at first. His first appearance shows him slaying a minion for failing him, but he quickly becomes your standard 80s cartoon villain. You know, the type of bad guy who always loses to the heroes, yet for some reason remains a threat. The relationship between Link and Zelda can be strange, with Link continuously pursuing a kiss from Zelda. It can feel creepy.
Oh boy, smooching time!
Besides that, this is probably the best Zelda cartoon we could have gotten for the time. Link's characterization may feel off, especially considering how the modern games have turned him into a silent protagonist. Still, we commend them for even bothering to give him one. Link in the show is a teen who yearns to be a great hero, which doesn't feel like too much of a stretch for his personality. And you gotta love his iconic catchphrase, "Well, excuse me, princess."
Well, excuse me, princess.
While it has its odd moments, the relationship between him and Zelda can be entertaining. The pair's bickering mirrors an old married couple. The show makes frequent use of the game's music and sound effects. It's a nice addition, even if the classic theme might get repeated too often. The Legend of Zelda wasn't a hit when it aired, only airing 13 episodes. Despite that, it remains a favorite for those who watched it as children. The cast of the show even got to reprise their roles in Captain N after this series was canceled. It's a cheesy show, but the fun kind of cheesy. It's less like a glorified commercial for the games and more like a serious attempt at bringing those titles to life. With no new animated Zelda adaptations in sight, it might be just worth it to give this one a go. We're leaving Hyrule and going to the Mushroom Kingdom. Next is the Super Mario Bros. Super Show. We're actually covering three shows in this entry. After Super Show ended, we got The Adventures of Super Mario Bros. 3, which was then followed by Super Mario World. Some characters were dropped and voice actors were changed, but they were essentially the same show, hence why we're grouping them together. The show revolves around the Mario Brothers and their adventures in the Mushroom Kingdom. Interestingly, the Super Show episodes would actually open and close with live-action skits featuring Mario and Luigi. They worked as Brooklyn plumbers, who then end up in the kingdom after going down a drain. From that point on, the episodes are animated, capturing the Mushroom Kingdom in all its cartoon glory. Overall, this series is hit and miss. There are a lot of weird choices which we don't feel add to the Mario world. Many early episodes focus entirely on parodies of then-recent movies, like RoboCop and Indiana Jones. Kind of a strange choice for a Super Mario cartoon, right? In general, the show was more interested in capturing the zeitgeist of the late 80s and early 90s than it does the spirit of the Mario Brothers series. You have episodes focused on 80s films and Milli Vanilli, and you can't help but think it's out of place in a cartoon based on this franchise. On the plus side, the series does a good job at representing the characters and worlds, even if it doesn't always seem like the priority. Characters and locations from all the classic Mario games are present. There are even musical cues lifted from the games too. The characters all act like you'd expect them to, with Bowser being loud and bossy and Luigi being cowardly and clumsy. We also like the relationship between Mario and Luigi. They fight and argue with each other like real siblings, leading to some of the more endearing moments of the show. Even though they argue a lot, they still care for each other, giving their relationship a depth not usually seen in the franchise. The show also gets better as it goes along, with the Super Mario World segments being among the best in the whole series. With this being the only major animated outing for the Mario franchise, this might be one to check out for yourself. It's a mixed bag, but we think there's more good to this one than bad. We're plugging in our old Genesis and jumping into the world of Sonic with the adventures of Sonic the Hedgehog. The first cartoon with the fastest thing alive focuses on Sonic and his pal Tails as they try to foil the plans of the mad scientist, Dr. Robotnik. When you bring this show up to fans, the chances are high that they'll describe this show as the weird and zany Sonic cartoon. That's an apt description. This show is a classic Roadrunner cartoon, but applied to the world of Sonic. Not a bad source for inspiration, we must admit. The characters are insane, the expressions are all over the place, and there is zero logic. At times, it can feel overbearing, but it never gets boring. This is something we can't say about some of the lower shows on this list. Sonic and Tails are fun protagonists, even if they don't have much depth. This is a show where the villains shine more often than the heroes. Dr. Robotnik is always a blast, and voice actor Long John Baldry fits the role perfectly.
I got Sonic! I win!
You also have new villains in Scratch, Grounder, and Coconuts. They're the classic idiotic subordinates, and they take their appearances from enemies in the game. We rank adventure so high because, as we stated earlier, there's never a dull moment. From slapstick to corny PSAs that close out episodes, there's always something off the wall happening. It's certainly not the best Sonic cartoon. It doesn't take advantage of the game's potential, but it's too fun of a series to hate. It's better than Sonic Underground, that's for sure. Besides, without this show, we wouldn't have gotten all those Dr. Robotnik YouTube poops. We can't possibly take that for granted. Our next choice might be controversial, but we're gonna go with it anyway. It's 2018's Mega Man Fully Charged. When this show premiered, to say it was unpopular with fans would be putting it lightly. Fans detested the changes in mythology and aesthetics. Cartoon Network didn't appear to think much of the show either, airing it only in the early mornings with little in the way of advertising. But what if we were to say this show not only isn't as bad as many think, but it's actually alright? Like, don't get us wrong, there are definitely flaws. Many of the deviations from the games have us scratching our heads. Like, Dr. Wily is not the antagonist. The new villain in his place is forgettable, and the only Wily is Burt Wily, a friend and classmate of Mega Man. Mega Man also has a sidekick in the form of Mega Mini. He also has a human sister instead of a robot one. These changes seem more superfluous than anything else.
Toddlers and toaster bots are off limits!
They leave you wishing you were seeing the characters from the games and not these weird replacements. Besides that, this show is delightful. We mentioned before that our biggest misgiving with the Ruby Spears adaptation was that it felt more like a superhero cartoon than a Mega Man cartoon. That problem isn't present in this cartoon. The show likes to look at the relationship between man and machine that was often present in the games. It never goes beyond the surface level, but it does far more with those ideas than the 90s cartoon. The show even introduces some neat ideas into the Mega Man universe. Everyone is familiar with Mega Man's ability to copy other robots' abilities. In this show, he also takes their personalities. For example, after taking Fireman's powers, he also becomes angry and hot-headed. It's a cool concept, and one that hasn't been seen in other adaptions. Like the Ruby Spears cartoon, this one is filled with robot masters from the games, and some fun original ones. Bottom line, this might be one to give a second chance. If you love the games or Man of Action's previous work, don't listen to all the hate, and give this one a fair shot. Next is 1993's Sonic the Hedgehog, or SAD-AM, as it is sometimes referred to. The show is set in a world where Dr. Robotnik has conquered Mobius and turned it into the mechanized Robotropolis. It follows Sonic and a team of freedom fighters as they attempt to overthrow his evil rule.
Gotta juice it loose!
We're all accustomed to shows based on beloved franchises running for a few years and then ending in favor of a new series. This show is interesting because it began weeks after the first Sonic cartoon, Adventures of Sonic the Hedgehog, began airing. Yeah, there was a time where viewers could watch two different Sonic cartoons with completely different takes on the source material. The only thing shared between the two is Sonic's voice actor, Jaleel White. While Adventures was quirky and slapstick-oriented, SAD-AM is darker and more focused on story. While a dark Sonic cartoon might seem like a silly idea, SAD-AM proves the idea could work. This series is easily the most entertaining out of all the 90s Sonic cartoons. The new characters, including the heroic Sally Acorn and the cowardly Antoine, are welcomed additions to the franchise. After you get to know them, it's easy to see why so many fans still adore these characters. Dr. Robotnik is a fantastic villain in the series. While we love Long John Baldry's performance and Adventures, we also have to give a huge round of applause for the sinister vibes Jim Cummings provides the character with. The show is dark, but it never feels like it's being edgy for the sake of it. The same goes for the more comical aspects of the show. The dark and lighthearted moments are balanced well, and they never bleed into each other. The animation is dark but breathtaking, making it one of the best-looking cartoons of its time. The backgrounds look amazing, making Robotropolis appear both beautiful and grotesque. There's even plot progression, which is essentially unheard of for a video game cartoon in this era. You'll become intrigued by the show's story, wondering how the Freedom Fighters are gonna stop Robotnik and free Mobius. Sadly, some things are too good to last, and SAD-AM ultimately ended on a cliffhanger. Any chance of a revival feels like wishful thinking at this point. Still, the show lived on in the Archie Comics Sonic series, which was based heavily on this cartoon. SAD-AM remains the best 90s adaptation of a video game and one of the best adaptations in general. If you enjoyed the Sonic series, we guarantee that you'll love this one. We've made it to the top three, people! Earning the bronze medal is Kirby, right back at ya! From the very beginning, this show starts off on the right foot. Both Nintendo and series creator Masahiro Sakurai were very involved with this project, giving the show a feeling of accuracy that many others don't have. In this series, Kirby ends up in Dreamland, and his arrival upsets King Dedede. He does everything in his power to take out Kirby, but Kirby isn't alone. He meets the siblings Tiff and Tuff, and much of the show follows them in their many adventures. Right Back At Ya is a warm and endearing show. You've got all the usual characters and locations, and everything is totally in line with the games. You would think giving the Kirby cast voices and personalities would lead to some strange choices, but they feel completely natural. Kirby's almost like an infant in this series, which stands out in a sea of generic and stoic protagonists in these adaptations. Dedede is a ton of fun too. The voice actor is perfectly cast in the role, and once you hear his voice, you'll never see Dedede without thinking of it. There are definitely some generic episodes in the series, but it's such a charming watch that you don't mind those. Even the more simplistic and mundane episodes can be a source of lots of fun. Many fans say this show introduced them to the franchise, and it's hardly a bad entry point. It's an endearing series for fans and newcomers alike, and that is why we put it in third place. Nintendo's even proud of the show, as they frequently reference the series since its end. You certainly can't say they felt that way about, say, Donkey Kong Country. In second place, we have the Blue Blur's most recent animated adventure, Sonic Boom. Based on the Sonic Boom subseries, this show follows Sonic, Tails, Knuckles, Amy, and Styx, all Hedgehog Village residents. They work together to defend their home from all kinds of villains, ranging from ferocious monsters to Dr. Eggman. Sonic Boom is a treat. The show is constantly tossing out jokes left and right.
I'm a doctor, not a real doctor.
And thankfully, the majority of them land. Each episode has at least one standout joke. Knuckles is definitely the show stealer, as he's where much of the comedy comes from. Alright, besides some great comedic writing, the show has a lot to offer longtime fans of the franchise. There are plenty of references to both the games and the fandom. They go as far as to reference the weird Knuckles jump glitch that was often mocked in the Sonic Boom video game. Some other classic characters appear in the series, like Shadow the Hedgehog and Vector the Crocodile. Like Kirby before it, Sonic Boom prides itself on its respect to the source material. Sega actually produced it to some extent, Also, all the characters share the voice actors from their game counterparts, giving it another layer of authenticity.
I can't feel my everything.
At times, Sonic Boom does feel like your typical adventure comedy cartoon we've seen plenty of in the last decade. However, it's undeniably one of the best in that genre. Practically every episode is guaranteed to get a few laughs. We tell you to watch it, but if you love Sonic, you probably have already watched it. If that's the case, watch it again. Hey, it beats playing the Sonic Boom video game. Securing the gold medal for Best Video Game Adaptation is 2017's Castlevania. This Netflix original takes inspiration from a few games from the franchise, most notably Castlevania 3. After Dracula's wife is killed, he blames the people of Wallachia for her death. He releases an army of monsters to punish the people, but three stand in the way of his revenge: the hunter Trevor Belmont, the magician Sypha, and Alucard, Dracula's son. The trio join forces to defeat Dracula's minions and keep Wallachia safe. Castlevania is a video game adaptation that feels unlike any others on the list. It's not focused on advertising toys, and it's definitely not for kids. It's a show that was made because the creators love these games. They want to capture the feeling of those titles in an animated outlet. In terms of capturing the world of the games, the show does a phenomenal job. The world presented in the series is dark and gothic, much like the games it took inspiration from. There's also plenty of action and violence. This is not at all a show for the squeamish. The action is some of the best in Western animation, and there's plenty of variety. You'll see everything from fistfights to sword duels. The characters are also compelling. The creative team did an excellent job giving life to roles that didn't have much depth in the original games. Trevor Belmont is an exceptionally refreshing protagonist. It's always nice to see a lead who's kind of a screw-up. It makes him stand out, as the other protagonists on this list are your typical do-gooders. We also have to mention the animation. Castlevania is one of the most gorgeous cartoons not only in the world of video game adaptations, but for animation in general. We'll also give the show tons of credit for single-handedly keeping the Castlevania franchise alive. Given that Konami is showing no interest in creating new games in the series, it has fallen onto this show to keep this franchise afloat. It's pretty interesting how our choice for worst adaptation killed its franchise. And the best adaptation is the one thing keeping its series alive. We don't want to delve too deep into the show, as it only recently finished, so you should really give it a look for yourself. Whether you're familiar with the games or not, give this show a chance. We promise that you won't regret it. Alright guys, that's the list. Let us know in the comment section, which video games-based cartoon is the best? Do you agree with our ranking? And tell us what we should cover next. Remember to hit that notification bell and binge more of our videos. But most importantly, stay wicked.